Okay, I shall start. Let's not waste time. So basically, currently I'm actually a product engineer at Airfoil, and basically we are actually trying to build NIRA, this internal project ourselves, and I'll talk more about it. So yeah. Right, so I'm Jerald. So basically I graduated 2 years ago. Basically I'm working as a software engineer for about a few years, 2 years. To probably close to 3 years. And yeah, if you're interested, you can hit me up on the following platforms. And I think I'll do a short introduction about Airfoil and what we are. So basically, Airfoil actually started out as a design agency, basically to provide founders with basically design, you know, the designs and product design and everything. And currently, we're actually venturing into engineering. So we are actually providing end-to-end services from designing to engineering. And anyone interested, you can hit Airfoil up at Twitter or even, you know, hit our website at airfoil.studio. And we are actually hiring, not at this one, but yeah, if you are interested for front engineers. So this agenda is quite straightforward. I'll go right into it. What's Mira? So Mira is actually an internal tool. An internal product we actually want to build to actually allow readers to actually read and share newsletters. So actually the pain point about this, why we actually started this product, is that not me, but my friend Gabriel actually shared this with me, is that what happens is that we want to be a newsletter aggregator. So because usually when you actually subscribe to newsletters, you actually use your own emails and stuff. So we actually use that, all the newsletters will actually come to your email inbox. And sometimes when you subscribe to multiple email newsletters, it's actually quite hard to read the newsletter itself because you need to organize it. You need to find out where is the newsletters and everything. So I would say this is a platform they actually built to actually enable people to read and share newsletters. So without further ado, I actually will do a quick demo of the website. One thing is that currently we are still building it, and I think it'll be beta soon. So pardon if some things that you see are, you know, not perfect yet. So this is the landing page itself. I can actually sign out and sign in again. So this is the what you see. So we are signing in. Just do a quick sign in. And this is basically the landing page itself. So basically, there are basically three small sections. In this case, is the today. So basically based on what you are subscribed to, the newsletter you are subscribed to, they will give you certain recommendations. And so what we actually do here is that we will actually display the HTML content on iframe and display it to the user itself. And other than that, we have the discover page. So basically, currently we're actually aggregating several newsletters, basically collecting them and displaying them. So one of it is Signal V Noise. So if you're familiar with it, I'm not that familiar. I just got into email newsletters a while back because of the influence of Gabriel, my friend. So yeah, you can see what we can do is that we can actually have the newsletters here read through. Currently, some of them are duplicated. Apologies for that. And you can actually, you know, click to read later. You'll be safe. You can go to later page and can see that it's actually there. So, yeah, pretty much, I would say this is what we have right here. There are still some features that we want to, have before we actually go to beta with this. Yeah. So I think without further ado, I will go down into the technical challenges that we have faced thus far, and as well as some tech choices that we made. So before that, I'll go to the tech stack. So basically the front end, you can see it's not, I didn't build it. It's basically built by another front end engineer. I'll introduce later, Zachary. So he actually built it using Nux deployed on Netlify. And for backend, it's very simple. We actually have a microservice layer using Rails. And database is Postgres, and for search is use the simple, most people use Elasticsearch as well. So with this, I'll talk about the interesting challenges that we find. So one of the technical challenges we have is with cursor pagination. So one of it is that, so in I'll explain more about cursor pagination and what it's about. So basically, we are using GraphQL in our application itself. So in GraphQL, you actually have like before after a certain item. You have to find out what comes after a certain item and what comes before a certain item. So what I realized is that I was using the typical cursor pagination logic, but I realized that it's not working, and I no idea why, and I realized that it's because that the model primary key set to the unique identifier. So basically, UID is actually a long string of text that doesn't really have any order, and usually the pagination logic using order to uses some order to actually return you results. So I actually Googled around and spent some time on this and actually need to change the pagination logic to actually use the basically in Rails we have updated that. So we should use that together with the UID to actually filter out the results and return it to the front end itself. It's quite interesting because when it first doesn't work, I was thinking, why would it not work? It's basically just simple pagination. And yeah, it actually took a while to actually get arrived at the solution. So yeah, continue to share. Next one is we have a need to actually scrub newsletter content. So let me explain further. So on the right-hand side is actually a newsletter you will see on a typical when you receive on your email itself. So you can see usually at the bottom you have this section where they will actually it's actually required to actually return you a section where you have to where you are able to unsubscribe if you do not wish to receive newsletters from this provider anymore. So what we do right here is that we don't want it to be here because we are newsletter aggregator, so we don't want the newsletter to have this where the users are actually unsubscribing on our behalf. So currently we have success with some of the one approach that we have. So basically what we do is we actually get the different newsletters from the same publisher from around the same time. And we'll compare and the difference to spot the unsubscribe, this unsubscribe section. And we actually remove it. And it works for, I would say, 80% of the newsletter out there that we have. But for around 20% of it actually removes some other static content that is similar in two different newsletters from the same publisher. So we have to handle this edge case differently, but we are still working on it right now. And another food for thought. So let me explain the approach is that what we do is we basically just get the HTML content. We get the div for both we compare the div for both HTML contents and we spot a difference. Currently, we are only removing the difference in content at the bottom because usually subscribing, unsubscribe section always come usually come at the bottom. So I actually remove that, but some of it, which works for most cases, and but the problem is that some at the bottom of some newsletter email newsletters, there are actually content that we don't want to remove. So we're actually finding ways to actually avoid that problem that we have. And upon further look, just a food for thought, we actually have several advertisements that we have that is in the newsletters. So we will actually want to remove them to actually improve readers' experience. So if you have any thoughts for this, you can share because I've actually can't ever actually tackle this problem yet. So it'd be good to hear any opinions. So I'll move on to technical choices that we made. So I think one of the technical choices that we made is quite new. So we've been using this website called Render to actually deploy our applications. So I would say it's quite interesting because in some way it's quite similar to Heroku. I only use Heroku once, so I'm not very familiar. But I would say Render give a very very simple experience and very easy to deploy. The deployment, I would say I set it up. The simple deployment takes about 5 to 10 minutes, but to set up the domain and everything takes a while more. But using Cloudflare with Render, so it's really quite simple. So but the problem is that I would say the costs rack up pretty quickly. So I'll say we have our database and everything, database, Elasticsearch, and we have probably their microservice and another layer. All these actually rack up prices. I would say currently we are racking up close to $100 right now. So I'll say we have to scale down and see how we can achieve this. Yeah, so this is one thing that we have. And our technical choice that we have is that Rails out of the box provide action mailbox. So this actually allow us to actually ingest emails easily using, so basically we're using SendGrid, and with the mailbox with SendGrid, we can just plug and play action mailbox and ingest the emails, allow us to actually not care about ingesting emails and care more about what content we want to show to our users itself. And setting up pretty fast because Rails actually has the guide itself. Yeah, so these are the technical choices that we made. I think coming to the end, I will give credits to, let's say, the front-end engineer, Zachary. He built on this, and this project won't be here without our CEO at Airfoil. So you can follow either of them on LinkedIn or Twitter if you're interested. And I think to this, we come to the end of the presentation. You all can ask any questions if there is. Yeah.
I have one question. You mentioned that you use the Action Mailbox, right?
Yes.
So, which means that your app subscribes to all the newsletter out there.
Correct.
And then whatever the your users subscribe to in a way, like on your app, and then you will show them subsequently.
Yeah, correct. Okay. So one thing we are actually, I don't say it's a problem, it's more of like we are actually subscribed to about 500 newsletters right now, but it's still ongoing. But I think one thing that we want to do in the future is that we want to allow users to actually have the ability to actually add newsletters. So maybe there are some newsletters which the readers might be interested in, but maybe we are not subscribed to. So we actually want the ability to actually allow users to actually subscribe to newsletters that they want. And hopefully these newsletters, if they're interested in, we can actually share it to other users as well, so that people can be exposed to the different newsletters that are out there.
Mm.
Yeah.
Okay. So like giving your users the ability to like introduce newsletter, but then this part of how to let them introduce and then the data coming into your entire app, all these are like not thought about yet, right?
It's we actually thought about it. So basically we are going to give a customized email to every user. So the customized email will be very specific to the particular user itself. So they can actually use the email to actually subscribe to newsletters. And whatever newsletter they actually subscribe to, the email newsletters will just come to them for now. We haven't thought about how do we actually enable the sharing of newsletters that the particular user is actually interested in. So maybe let's say, for example, we are not subscribed to Ruby Weekly, which is not the case, but for example, if that's the case, then the user subscribe to Ruby Weekly. We haven't actually thought about a way to actually share Ruby Weekly to everyone yet. Mm. Yeah.
Mm. Okay. And like just curious, I haven't used Render before, but I keep hearing about it. Mm. And I know there's like an alternative to Heroku, which basically is another path, right? Then they're just curious, like, I'm not sure whether you have context, but how do you make the decision to choose Render over Heroku? Or was it just because you don't know how to use it?
I think the decision for using Render is basically, first is that I think we want to try, because everyone has been talking about Render, as you mentioned.
Mm.
So I think we want to try something new and we want to see whether it's live up to its expectations, which I think it is. Because I think the problem is quite straightforward, because every time you can actually hook it up to the GitHub repo and every time you push anything to a feature branch or to a master, you can actually, they will actually deploy it right away. So I think it's quite easy. And all the features are there. The support is quite good, I would say. Usually get, we have questions, we usually, there's a sort of like a forum. You just post it there. Within a day, you really can get the problem resolved. Yeah.
Mm.
But comparing Heroku and Render, I don't really have much experience with Heroku. So actually, Gabriel made this choice to actually go with Render. I just went ahead with it and, you know, see how it goes. Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
Actually, for the removing of the footer, the unsubscribe footer, right? Like,
yeah.
You say you're compared from the different sources.
We compare from the same source but different newsletter. So like a publisher usually publish like newsletter weekly or maybe like on a bi-weekly newsletter. So we'll compare the same newsletter, same newsletter from the same source but different dates, and we'll compare and get the probably the bottom. We get the bottom and we remove it. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, because I was thinking that might be possible to like also do it using like do some like keyword matching, because usually most of them, they will have some address or like some company email or etc.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, take note of that and try it out. Yeah.
So I think the part on the removing advertisement, right, I think it might be very hard. Cause no, I think more of like it's very hard to differentiate what is an advertisement, what is not advertisement, right? Because it could be an advertisement, but it could be relevant to the content also.
Yes.
Yeah. So I'm not sure how you're gonna do that.
Yeah, I don't think that will be, I don't think that's the problem that we'll tackle now. Probably I think we'll probably release it first, get it out to people to use it first. And once we get out there, then we will start to think about the problem.
Yeah. Yeah, actually curious, right? You said you all face this pagination issue because the primary key is the UUID.
Yeah.
But if I'm not wrong, Rias, the default is the like 1, 2, 3, the numerical, right? Like
yes,
your,
the
is there a reason that you all change the primary key to that?
Reasons for changing the right. Yeah, Rails default ID is that or the I don't actually have an answer to your question, sorry. So basically I joined this project while my friend Gabriel was working on this project. So some of the technical choices I didn't really question, because I think we have time, we want to basically build our product. So yeah,
because I remember for my own product, like because we imported, we caught some API and then got some data from somewhere. They also used UID, and then because of that, it broke quite a lot of things that the default like Rails thing. Especially like, I think if you use Elasticsearch, probably use like search key or something, then it will also break the other stuff.
Yeah,
that was quite painful for us also.
Yeah. So for your I would say I'm quite sure you're working on Noteflare, right?
Yeah.
Or Noteflare using order ID, as in the basically the simple 1, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah, we sort of have to patch it to use a numerical ID instead. I think a lot of the gems, they sort of assume that's the default.
Yeah. Correct. Yeah.
I also like ran into this problem before. But I used the basically I didn't change to UUID. I still use like the big integer, but then somehow, right, I still have to sort my ID. Although it's like big in already, but I still have to like intentionally like sort it by something, like even if by the ID that I want to sort. So I think that like even with the default Rails one, you still have to think about how you want to sort it. When you pull the data, it will just not, like if you didn't do an order by, right, it will probably not come out as you expected anyway.
You, for the pagination, you implemented it yourself or is it some kind of like gem?
So So basically, we use GraphQL. So basically, for GraphQL, the pagination wise, it's not. I think you can use Graph. I'm not sure about this, but I think you can get GraphQL Pro. Then they will have like inbuilt pagination like for you. But using the GraphQL free version, so there isn't any pagination. I mean, you have to implement it yourself. So we actually just wrote interface, and it's basically pagination is quite straightforward. So, but I didn't think about the UID problem until I faced it. So that's one problem too. That's one interesting problem that actually that I faced and fix it. So it was quite interesting because I didn't expect myself to face this problem, and I faced it anyway. So yeah.
I actually use this gem called Aminari, and like it traditionally was used more like, okay, you have a front end view and then you use ERB, and then it allow you to do all the pagination, like footer, click next, all these things like out of the box. But I realized that that because they add the helper methods into your model, like your active record, right? So then actually you don't really need to use the view. You still can easily like do pagination and pull data and then render it with like GraphQL or whatever you want to. So in general, I'm using this and it's already like quite good.
I use this also, and I think if I'm not wrong, quite a few of those like database like wrapper, they integrate with this also. Like for example, like I think the search kit gem for the elastic search one, they also like can integrate with this lah.
Yeah, it's quite easy. It's just like out of the box. You just add one, and then they give you some ways to configure it also. I think it's quite neat. Yeah. Okay. Anybody else have any questions? Yeah. Okay. Then maybe like one last question I have. Then, you mentioned like Mira, you guys are like in beta stage right now, right? Like what is the near future plans or something that. Like launch? Do you all have like planning to launch soon or something?
Yeah. So I think once beta is over, we will basically launch it. And basically once beta is over, we'll launch it. So I think according to our CEO Phil, so basically he actually has several contacts, and some of them are actually quite interested in this product. So I think basically. Context is that he's basically shuffling between Canada and San Francisco. So basically he has certain contacts that are actually interested in this product. So once we get out of beta and people are interested, we can probably get some funding to actually move this product further.
I think as a user, the one where like, because I guess you're gonna like mess like a quite a bit of like newsletter content, right? I think the part will be quite interesting is that like you can recommend me like a user like what they a newsletter they didn't thought they want based on that attributes or something.
That's one thing that is in the pipeline. So basically how usually apps do recommendation, they ask you for your what categories what do you actually watch or look at? Then, based on that, they will do some recommendations. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Awesome. I think.
Okay, like, thank you.
That's it.
Yeah.
Thanks for the sharing.
No problem.
So now I'm just like, just close it up. So.